just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there's peace within your presence. I speak Jesus, sing his name. Jesus, he's a name above all names. Jesus, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains.
Shout of praise this morning.
We've seen what you can do, O God of wonders. Your power has no end. The things you've done before, in greater measure, you will do again. There's no prison wall you can't break through, no mountain you can't move on. Things are possible. There's no broken body you can't erase, no soul that you can't save. All things are possible. The darkest night, you can light it up. Yeah, you can light it up. Oh, God of revival, let hope arise. Oh, God of revival.
awaken your people. Come awaken this city. Oh God of revival, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. I hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God of revival, pour it out.
So if you do not have an emblem, you don't have a cup with the bread and the juice, would you just raise your hand and an usher can get it to you? I want to urge us to think of this time, as we enter into this time of communion, as a bit of an opportunity for a reset. To get back, to humble ourselves, to be back at Jesus' feet, to think of ourselves as a living and holy sacrifice to God, remembering why we get to be here, why we get to do it, how we got here, how we get to be filled with the Spirit, saved by Jesus through his sacrifice. In Ephesians 6, it talks about putting on the armor of God. And one of the things that always sticks out to me is when you put on the sandals of peace or shoes of peace, it says the peace that comes from the preparedness or the readiness to preach the good news or to preach the gospel. Which in order for that to happen, in order for you to have the peace on your feet that comes from that, we have to be ready to preach it. It has to be in our hearts. It has to be stored. It has to be tucked away in our hearts in order for that peace to be there. It's a prerequisite, church. And so I pray for us today, and I pray for myself that we never forget the impact, the revelation of how Jesus saved us. The opportunity we get. The fact that we get to have a relationship with him. I pray for us that it never wears off. Because I think we need a healthy amount of fear of what could happen if that revelation wears off, if that novelty, that newness wears off, that impact wears off. The second we forget that, the second we forget who we are, it's not something we can compromise on. In Exodus 13, it talks about giving your firstborn. It talks about the sacrifice of the firstborn or your first fruits. And it says, in the future, your children will ask you, what does this all mean? And you will tell them, with the power of his mighty hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt, the place of our slavery. Pharaoh stubbornly refused to let us go. So the Lord killed all the firstborn males throughout the lands of Egypt, both people and animals. And that is why I now sacrifice the firstborn males to the Lord. Except that the firstborn sons are always brought back. This ceremony will be a mark branded on your hand or your forehead. It is a reminder that the power of the Lord's mighty hand brought us out of Egypt. We can't afford to forget. Can't afford to forget what he did for us. The second, Israel forgot where the Lord had brought them and what he had done. Is they forgot who they were. They forgot who chose them to be his people. They forgot who they were supposed to be, and they got distracted, and they started doing all these other things. The second we forget the peace that comes from the good news, the second we lose that readiness, is the second we forget who we are. So the importance of this, which they understood. In Luke 22, the disciples are gathered around sitting with Jesus, and he takes some bread and thanks God for it. And then he broke it in pieces and gave it to the disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So church, would you ready your bread? Let's do this in remembrance that Jesus laid his body down to be broken for us, that the veil could be torn, that we could enter in a relationship with him. We could be saved. Remember that the Savior paid the ultimate price, beat sin in the grave out of love. That was his motivation. And it's what our motivation should be. So let's take the bread together. After supper, he took the cup of wine and said, "This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood, which is poured out as a sacrifice for you." In Hebrews 9:14, it says, "How much more then will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciousness from acts that lead to death, so that we may serve the living God?" And it says, "Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness." If Jesus didn't do it, we wouldn't be forgiven. We wouldn't get to be a living and holy sacrifice. We wouldn't get to be here. Church, can I remind us, it's a blessing to be here. It's a blessing to be his kid. It's a blessing to do his work, to serve him, to worship him, to praise him, to put him first. We get to do this. He shed his blood out of love for us as a sacrifice. As we think about that, let's take the juice together. Jesus, today we thank you. God, I can't thank you enough. I can't praise you enough to repay what you did for us. And the beauty of it all is that you didn't ask for anything in return other than just ourselves, just to go back to you. We were created to be yours. We were yours from the get-go, and we ran away, and what did you do? You died so we could be purchased through your blood, to be redeemed through your blood. I can't thank you enough. God, I ask that you never let us forget. Don't let us forget what you've done. Help us store it away in our hearts, God. The beauty of what you've done, the beauty of who you are, who we are because of you. So God, as we head into this time of 21 days of prayers, as we just move forward throughout our day, our week, our lives, God, help us put every circumstance aside and get back to what matters. Every issue on the table, every bill, every stress, everything in the way, God, it pales in comparison to what you did on the cross, of who you called us to be. So God, I ask that we just lay it down at your feet this morning. I'm yours again. Church, would you say that with me? Jesus, I'm yours again. I've always been yours. Thank you, Jesus. So we just praise you. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know it was the blood. Only been the blood. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I know it was the blood. Could have only been the blood. Could have only been the blood.
Cause it's never been about performance, perfection, or striving for acceptance. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. It's never been about deserving or earning. It's a gift that's freely given. Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Does anybody want to be holy and righteous, purified and spotless? Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Does anybody want to be worthy, forgiven, justified, really living? Let me tell you, it's only by the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I know it was the blood, could have only been the blood. Now I draw a boundary against every weapon that's formed. The thief and his plans will pass over when he sees the red on the door. I plead the blood. Take my family, cause this home belongs to the Lord. So I'm not afraid to remind him that he has no claim in this war. I plead the blood. I plead the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus. 'Cause my future is glory to glory, and my freedom's been purchased in full. For all of the weight of his suffering, the Lamb will receive his reward. I plead the blood.
There's power in the blood. There's still power in the blood.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood. Nothing but the blood.
schools and over our cities. I plead the blood, I plead the blood over the darkness and over the enemy. I plead the blood, and I plead the blood over my children and over my family. I plead the blood, I plead the blood over my future and over my body. I plead the blood, I plead the blood over my schools and over our cities. I plead the blood, I plead the blood over the darkness and over the enemy. I plead the blood, I plead the blood.
Away my sin.
Come on, church. God, would you just praise him right now? I feel right now that God is doing something in this room, that the Spirit is moving, and we need some breakthrough. We need to stand in agreement with God right now on some breakthrough. I know many of us came in here this morning with something on our hearts, something on our minds, something standing in the way between us and Jesus, something that made us feel like maybe we couldn't talk to him, or maybe we weren't worthy of this relationship, or maybe that we just did something too bad. We can't get over it. Or someone did something to us. Something is standing in the way this morning, and I pray right now in the name of Jesus that be gone. The enemy has no foothold on us in this room. Shame, fear, doubt has no foothold in this room. Right now, we plead the blood of Jesus over our families, over our relationships, over everything in our lives, God, because we need you, God, and we can't do it without you. And so right now, if you feel this right now, if you feel like God is pulling on something, something is standing in the way, there's a stronghold, there's a chain, you want freedom from something, I'm going to urge you right now as we move into this next song, would you just praise God? Ask him for joy into your heart. Praise God. Tear the strongholds down. Take the authority he has given you. Take the authority he's given you. He's not just our God. He's my God. He's your God. He's your Father. He moves. He breaks strongholds down. He breaks chains, and he does it every day. He heals every day. It's who he is, church. So can we just agree in that? Can we stand in agreement? God, today is your day. We are your kids. That person that's been put on your heart that doesn't know or hasn't seen it yet or hasn't realized that they're your kid, we pray for them right now. God, would you reveal yourself to them? Would you show yourself to them? Would you lead them back into your love? They've been purchased by blood through your son, Jesus Christ, and we stand in agreement for that. If you need prayer, if you need something right now, I urge you, can we get the prayer team to come up on the sides? If you need prayer, you need agreement in prayer, there is something you're battling. There is something you're struggling with. There is something the enemy's trying to get you. I urge you, come up and get some prayer. We want to agree with you. We want to see the chains fall, because it's not for us. It's for his glory. We want to see God do something, a miracle in this room this morning. In your heart, in the physical, in the spiritual, God is moving. And there's nothing keeping you in the way of that. God's gone before you. He's paved the way. So if you need prayer or anything right now, I urge you to come up and get some prayer from the prayer team. God, we just praise you.
Bibles to James chapter 5. Woo-hoo! And there you are. And if you're a guest with us this morning, we just are excited about the Word of God. Is it okay to be loud and talk in church? Yeah. As long as you're not talking about fishing or lunch or whatever you're going to do, unless you're inviting me to lunch. But you know, it is okay. My pastor always says a quiet church is a dead church. I'm not sure what that means, but we do like to make some noise. So feel free to preach with me today. But as we are launching into another 21 days of prayer, if you're new to this, we do this two times a year. I won't get into all of the explanation. We have a video actually that is online now. It's on our app. If you don't have our app, There are QR codes around the building. There's some cards, postcards that have information on how to get our app, how to sign up for the newsletter. All of these tools are given through that. And we actually made a video with a little bit of a tutorial on how to do that, how to get the push notifications on your phone or your mobile device. But the way that we divvy up the year is we kick off the year with 21 days of prayer and fasting, where we really lean in to hear the voice of the Lord, to press into Him, to start our year right. And then in August, it's prayer and feasting, if you want to fast, you can fast, but it's okay not to. But we take this time. It's a little less introverted and a little more extroverted, a little more outward focused each year. And this year, our theme very specifically is an outward focus and praying the will of God, the heart of God for the nations, for the harvest. And so more to come on that. But as we kick this off today, I thought it was fitting for us to set up right here and talk about fervent prayer. James chapter 5, verse 13. Is anyone among you suffering? Let him pray. Everybody say pray. Okay. God bless you. Have a great day. The Bible is pretty clear on God's expectation for the believer. Prayer is not an accessory. Prayer is not an afterthought. Prayer is not for those funny people. I won't say weird. Those people that hang out in the fireside room and, you know, that they call intercessors. Prayer is not just for those folks. Prayer isn't just for the pastors. Prayer isn't for the grandmas who spend time in their prayer closet. Although it is, prayer is essential for the believer, and more to come on that also. Is anyone cheerful? Let him sing psalms. Singing has something to do with prayer. Verse 14, is anyone among you sick? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them pray over him, anointing him with oil in the name of the Lord. Verse 15, and the prayer of faith, okay, so say prayer of faith. Will save the sick, and the Lord will raise him up. And if he has committed sins, he will be forgiven. Verse 16, confess your trespasses to one another and pray for one another that you may be healed. Here it is. The effective, fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much. Elijah was a man with a nature like ours, and he prayed earnestly that it would not rain. And it did not rain on the land for 3 years and 6 months. And he prayed again, and the heaven gave rain, and the earth produced its fruit. Well, the effective, fervent prayer of the righteous avail much. Now, if you read this in the New Living Translation, God's Word, easy to read, Children's Bible, many of the newer versions just say, prayer of someone who's right with God does cool stuff. Now, that's okay. That's a bit of a Joe paraphrase of these paraphrases. But I'm specifically in referring to the New King James because I just love the sound of effective, fervent prayer availing much. And if I really want to get spiritual, I'll say availeth much. We'll just throw some good old King James in there. But what is fervent prayer? Isn't prayer just prayer? I mean, who prays? Is prayer just for Christians? No. I mean, if you've ever been in a foxhole, prayer is for everybody. During COVID, prayer was for everybody. But there are just about every religion on the planet believes in prayer, has some type of prayer. Even people who say that they're not religious talk about praying, and they'll say phrases like, well, you better pray, or I'm just going to pray, even though prayer has a very different context. So fervent prayer, effective fervent prayer that the Bible is talking about isn't just prayer. There's some very specific characteristics about what the Bible is referring to as this kind of prayer. In fact, the word, what we translate effective fervent is actually one word. And it's interesting that over the centuries, the translators that have translated from Greek to different languages, especially to English, have struggled with this particular phrase, which is why now, like the New Living and a few other translations, just say prayer instead of effectual, fervent prayer. Because in actuality, the word, the Greek word, is energeo. Yes, it sounds a lot like energy. In fact, it's the same word that we get energy from. But the word energeo is not an adjective or an adverb. It is a verb. So when it is used with the word prayer, which in the English language is the verb in the sentence, in the Greek, it is actually two words that are together, and they are both verbs. I'm not sure. English scholars, can you do that in English? Two verbs together? Well, fortunately, the Greek can. But this word energeo is where we get energy. It's a verb, but it literally means to be operative, to be at work, to put forth power. There's a root word of this word, or that we have turned into a phrase, that means to literally to have something going on like boiling water. It means to boil over. It means the molecules in something are stirring and something's happening. That's what this word that translates so neatly now into prayer, and then, oh, I don't know, a few hundred years ago, translated into effectual, fervent, and then we said effective, fervent. But it translates into this word that we just say prayer, and the result is it does something. So fervent prayer is active, like to boil over. It works. It does something. It puts forth power. It engages something. It's like you have the hot rod, and the hot rod sounds great, and the pipes sound really cool, and it's rattling, but you don't really get the power until you put it in gear. This word that is translated effectual fervent prayer literally means put it in gear. Drop the clutch, buddy. We're going. That's what it means. Okay, so everybody doing okay? Like, I didn't know what that meant. What are we talking about? Can you tell? Pastor's not a mechanic, has no clue. Yes, we can. So if prayer isn't just prayer, according to Scripture, effective, fervent prayer, the kind of prayer that availeth much, that does much, according to Scripture, that says sick people will get healed, broken people will be put back together, stuff will happen, what makes up this kind of prayer? Now, let me just ask a question that should be obvious. Who can pray this kind of prayer? Can anybody pray this kind of prayer? Well, that was a loaded question. Hope you thought about your answer. Can anybody pray effectual, fervent prayer according to Scripture? Well, we're going to talk about that. I'm glad you asked. So what is effective, fervent prayer? Well, first of all, verse 15 says, and the prayer of faith will save the sick. First and foremost, this type of prayer that we're talking about, this fervent prayer, is the prayer of faith. You know, it's interesting that the way that this was translated was very specific. Even coming into English, which is a little bit sloppy, it says the prayer of faith. It doesn't say a prayer of faith. Reason being, this is actually making the prayer of faith a noun, which is a very specific type of prayer, which means if there's a prayer of faith, then there's a prayer that's not a prayer of faith. There's a prayer that's something else. It's a prayer like I heard a pastor recently preach a word, and he said that one of the things that we're the most guilty of that robs the power of prayer is we pray with an asterisk. And the asterisk is, if it's your will, if you want to, if you can, if you're able. Jesus was confronted with people with this kind of prayer, and they said, Lord, if you're able to heal my son. And he said, if? I'm able. He was taken aback by their asterisks, which, by the way, is not the prayer of faith. The prayer of faith, according to Hebrews 11, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things unseen. The prayer of faith is praying what you don't see yet as though it is, knowing that the one whom you're praying to and what you're praying about is just a matter of getting it done. It's just a matter, like I said a minute ago, of dropping the clutch. The power is there. It's all revved up. It's all ready to go. And it's just time to put it in gear. That's what this prayer of faith is. Now, in our culture especially, we hear a lot of prayer of wishing. Being around young kids at the school, students, I love it. And I try not to over theologically evaluate how they pray, because they're praying and it's awesome. And Jesus was very specific about the innocence of kids and how they should come to the Lord. But one of the things that always struck me that I tried to teach the kids is they would pray and say, okay, I want you to pray for us today. And they say, Lord, I wish that. And then they fill in the blank. And I love it. And it's just so sweet. And I know God hears it. But if you're 40 and you're praying like that, you should think about your prayer. You may not be praying the prayer of faith. You're praying the prayer of wish. Now, prayer has hope in it, but there is also a prayer that hopes that is not necessarily the prayer of faith. Like, okay, I just hope this prayer works. Okay, how about this one? Well, we've tried everything, so I guess we're just going to pray. That might not be the prayer of faith, or at least it didn't start that way. After it all comes crumbling down, now we're praying with faith. So it's the prayer of faith, you know, and the thing about the prayer of faith is it sounds and feels, and when I say feel, I'm not all about like the feeling, ooh, it's how we feel, but there is an atmospheric thing that happens with effectual fervent prayer. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Anybody huddled this morning when Cole started praying? So we were at a meeting this last week. Kathy Soddy was there, and we were doing planning for the wood cutting event coming up next month. And we're sitting around. We always start these meetings with prayer. And in this room is a mixed group of people, from Catholic to Mormon to question mark to different denominations. And they usually ask me to pray, but this time they said, who would like to pray? And Kathy happened to be in the meeting, and I said, oh, Kathy should pray. And so Kathy began to pray, and it was just, they thought they were just going to get a prayer to open a meeting. Like the dialogue, God, we're here because we have to be, and we're in this meeting, so... God, would you just do, Lord, your whatever kind of prayer. Amen. Okay, start the meeting. They were expecting that kind of prayer. And she began to pray the prayer of faith. And it wasn't long. It was about a minute. And at the end of the minute, everyone sat there with their mouths open, going, wow. And one of the brothers, I won't mention the religion that they're from, building next up here, looked at her and said, wow, will you pray at my funeral? The prayer of faith sounds and feels different than any other kind of prayer. Than the prayer of, oh, I just hope, or the prayer of, oh, I could be doing other things, or the prayer of mechanics, and I could go through my list of Joeisms on these other types of prayer, but I think you get the point. 1 John chapter 5, verse 14. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have the petitions that we have asked of him. The second element of a fervent prayer is confidence and boldness. Now, listen to this, these words. If we ask, he hears. If we know he hears, we know we have. Now, unfortunately, this could easily be twisted into a prosperity message that just says, well, you just, the Bible says you ask God for whatever and he's going to give it to you. Lamborghini! Six-pack abs. That is not what this is referring to. It very specifically says, according to his will, which, like I mentioned earlier, sometimes we make this phrase a footnote in our prayer that is actually kind of an excuse. That is not what this is talking about. Praying his will means praying what God wants. So the Bible says, pray for the sick and they will recover. So do I need to ask God if it's his will to pray for the sick? So it says it's not his will that any should perish, but all should come. All should come to repentance. All should come to Jesus. So should I, so is it his will that he would save my neighbors? Is it his will that he would save my kids? Is it his will that he would save my friends? Is it his will that he would save the world around me? Okay, so do I now need to put an asterisk that says, God, if it's your will, save them? No, I do not. But what we often do is we put the if it's your will in there just in case what we pray for doesn't happen right away or it's not seen. And really, we're doing it to save face. Come on, let's be honest. Right? Because we think it's about our reputation when we pray, which is oftentimes why Christians don't pray for people, because they're afraid that if they pray, someone's going to hear that they prayed, and then nothing's going to happen, and then someone's now going to go, well, what's up with your faith? Well, what's wrong with you? Well, that is definitely a problem. So how do we combat that? Well, if we ask according to his will, he hears. If we know he hears, we know we have. I need to know the will of God. I need to know the word of God. I need to have the heart of God. And if I have these things, if I know what is on my Father's heart, I can easily pray and be confident and know that when I pray for the sick, it's his will. When I pray for someone to come to Jesus, it's his will. When I pray for my city to come to the Lord, it's his will. When I pray over the school that they wouldn't be full of demonic nonsense, it's his will. So therefore, when I pray, I can rev the engine and drop the clutch, because there is something on that kind of prayer. Hebrews 4:16, let us therefore come boldly to the throne of grace. Boldly, what's that look like? I've shared this before, that, you know, the church belongs to everybody. It's your church. The building belongs to everybody. The church belongs to Jesus, right? We are the church. The building belongs to all of us. But my son, who has been here since he was 2, is very comfortable here. Now, at his age, he doesn't throw his shoes and coat off at the door when he first comes in. He waits until he gets into my office. But when he was little, he was so comfortable because this was home. We practically lived here, right, for 13 years, practically lived here. And so he would just come in, shoes off, jacket off, and just go in. He has a sleeping bag in the closet in my office. He used to fit in there. He doesn't anymore. And he just goes and hangs out. Why? Because he knows that, like, he has free access. He doesn't have to ask permission. Most people, when they come in, they come to Kenzie and they say, is Pastor Joe here? Can I see him? When Samuel comes in, fortunately now, you know, we have a lock on the door. I'm not teasing. I'm actually talking about the difference between having access as a son versus a guest. See, when we pray, we are not praying as guests. We are praying as sons and daughters of the Most High. So when I pray to my Father in heaven, I'm not worried. Listen, when I come into his presence, shoes off, coat off. probably even on the floor. He's never corrected me for it, you OCD parents. It's okay, I'm one of those. God doesn't correct me for it. Why? Because I have free access, and I have the ability to come to my Father. And so when I pray, I have this mindset that I have an open invitation to come. You know, my mom is the same way. My mom is one of my best friends, always has been. Special relationship, even to this day, going to her house, we just kind of go in. You know, as I've gotten older, I've kind of like questioned the boundaries sometimes where I'm like, okay, should I ring the doorbell? Should I just go in? And they still look at me like I'm an alien when I ring the doorbell. Like, come in already. You're a son. You don't have to stop and ring the doorbell. You know, and I was thinking about it. I mean, I still will just because I want to be respectful and make sure that my dad has his clothes on in the house. Love you, Dad. That was not the Holy Spirit. Might have been. But I think about the awkwardness for them if I don't act like I have an open invitation. Like, what happened? Why aren't you comfortable coming in? If Samuel suddenly was like asking permission to come hang out with me, I'd be like, what happened? What went wrong in our relationship that you have to ask permission to come? See, when you are confident in your relationship with the Lord, you can boldly come before the throne of grace and know that you have the invitation of your Father. Just come. Just show up. Sometimes we put so many walls, so many barriers between us and God that our prayers become mamby-pamby, they become watered down, they become mechanical, or we just don't pray because we act as though we are no longer sons and daughters. We act as though we don't have access. John 14:13, Jesus said, I will do anything you ask the Father in my name, so the Father will be given glory because of the Son. If you ask me to do something, I will do it. Luke 11:9, so I tell you to ask and you will receive, search and you will find, knock and the door will be opened to you. Everyone who asks will receive, the one who searches will find, and for the person who knocks, the door will be open. Believer, son, daughter of the Most High, for those that are in Christ, and this is the difference, I ask the question, can anybody pray the fervent prayer? You have to be in Christ. Because if you are not in Christ, you won't know who you are. Cole mentioned that earlier. If you forget who you are, you won't know how to come. If you don't know who you are, if your identity is not in Him, you won't actually be a son or a daughter. That was good preaching. But here's how the prayer of faith is activated. We have a full access pass. You know, I don't have time to get into it. In Matthew 27, Jesus is on the cross. It's a final moment on the cross. He cries out. He gives up his spirit. And the veil in the temple is torn from top to bottom. It is ripped in half. Now, if you don't know what the veil symbolized, in the Old Testament, the veil is what separated people from the manifest presence of God. Nobody got to go behind the veil except very specific time, very specific person. And listen, there was so much ceremonial cleaning and cleansing and stuff to go through. The priests would wear a rope on their foot and a bell, because just in case they got too close to the presence of God and their imperfection or they did something wrong, the bell would stop. And they would pull the rope to drag the body out. Because imperfection cannot exist in the presence of a perfect God. When Jesus died for us on the cross, the veil was torn completely, symbolizing that the access between us and God is now open. You have a full access pass to the Father because of what Jesus did for you. So if you are in Christ, the veil is torn. There is no separation. In fact, I would say if we have separation between us and God, we put it there. Because if you're in Christ, If the blood has been covered on your life, I could sing that song again today. Pleading the blood, man. Then you have a full access pass. Okay, I better hurry up and get to preaching. 1 John chapter 5. Now this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he will do it. Number three, the fervent prayer is partnered with God's heart and his will. I've already talked about this a little bit, and we'll get into it more as the month, as 21 days goes on. But Jesus, when he taught his disciples to pray, he prayed this phrase, Matthew 6, verse 10, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." If you want to make sure that you are praying God's will, pray his word. It's easy, because his word will never violate his will. Just can't happen. Just doesn't happen. But Jesus told the disciples to pray, "Your kingdom come, your will be done." He wasn't saying, "Say this phrase repeatedly and don't know what it means." He was teaching them the meaning of that phrase was praying that God's will would be done right here, that his kingdom would be right here. So when I'm praying, I'm not just praying aloof on God, "I don't know what you want to do, God, I'm not sure what's up, God, just help us, God, I'd like a sandwich." I mean, you could pray that. But Jesus very specifically was saying, pray that his will would be done right in this spot. Now, spot, like geographically? No. Right in this thing that you're praying for. Right in your family. "God, your will be done. Your kingdom come in my home, just like heaven. God, your heart, your will, your purpose be done right here in my body, just like heaven. Right here in this person. Right here in my neighborhood. Right here in my town. Right here in this thing. Right here in my job, just like heaven." See, if you and I can get in this place where we consider prayer a partnership with the will and purposes and heart of God, you won't pray amiss. And when you do pray, you will see, like the word says, you will see things availeth much. See, prayer, in essence, is communication, but prayer, when it is partnered with his heart and his will, is something different. We call it intercession. Intercession is a verb. It is not just some lofty philosophical thing. Intercession, literally, the word means to intercede. So, like, for instance, there's a wagon pulled by horses, and it's going toward the cliff. Maybe I could use a more current analogy. There is someone heading for a cliff. The brakes are out. They're doomed. Intercession is putting yourself in front of the vehicle to stop it. That's what intercession is. So this kind of prayer that the word is talking about that partners with the heart of God is a verb, it's an action that activates what God wants to do in that situation. It comes into agreement. The Bible talks about the power of the prayer of agreement. Listen, when we are praying according to the will, to the word, to the heart of God, we are coming into agreement with the Creator. And it is impossible for nothing to happen when you pray in agreement with his word. It is impossible. And the thing that's amazing to me, and I don't have time to explore this today, the thing that never ceases to amaze me is that he actually chose you and I to partner with him. He doesn't have to limit himself to us. We are the weakest link. We are. And yet he chooses to partner with you and I in prayer. And just a side note, I wonder sometimes what he thinks when we don't. "Hey, son, here's the keys to the car. Man, it's all shined up and it looks great. It's all ready to go, full of gas. I'm good, Dad." I don't think any parents ever heard that, right? Okay. Romans 8:26. Oh, sorry. I got ahead of myself. Prayer is partnered with the heart and the will of God. I want to talk really quick about burdens. Anybody ever have God give you a burden for something? Can I show hands? Okay, so most of you know what I'm talking about. A burden, like the word literally burden, means to carry something. It's to have something put on you. So I want to just take a moment to speak really practically. I'm kind of getting out of the preaching mode, and let me just teach something for a moment. We have the Word of God to know what His will is. We have the Spirit of God to lead us and guide us, but His Spirit and His Word will work together to place burdens in our hearts. And burdens have a very specific function. A burden is a motivator for us to do something. Let me give you an example. Yesterday, I had a full day, lots of stuff going on. I was busy. I had to prepare for the day. I had a bunch of videos to create and stuff. I had a lot going on. But I got a message from a friend yesterday. And when I got the message, there wasn't anything earth-shattering, but when I got the message, my heart just went, oh, I need to go spend time with him. And so I drove, and we went and had time. And, you know, it was a wonderful time. I was probably more blessed out of the time with my friend. But, you know, I walked away going, that was a Holy Spirit moment. God set us up to have a really cool, intimate time together, a good friendship time, and to encourage each other in the Lord. And that's not complicated. No one spoke in King James or New King James. You know, it wasn't the thus saith the Lord. The earth didn't shatter. There were no burning bushes. It was just a burden that was on my heart that led to what I believe is a supernatural moment. And I would say, I love all of the demonstrative supernatural things that God does and can do, but I would say the majority of the time when I see signs and wonders, it is just through a still small voice. It is just through a burden that He places on my heart for someone. And you know, there are times that I don't do well with it. There's times where I'll wake up in the morning and someone will be on my heart and I'll just go, oh, okay, Lord bless them, and I'll just move on. Chances are God put them on my heart because I needed to pray or I needed to call and say something. And the majority of the times that I listen to that burden, the majority of the times God does something special. He either brings a word of encouragement, He brings healing, He brings something together. And so I would just say, church, praying fervent prayers should come from this place of allowing the Lord to put burdens on your heart, and instead of dismissing them, ignoring them, or just going, ooh, that must have been the heartburn from the pizza we ate yesterday, of actually doing something with that burden. And I would say, the more connected I am to the heart of God, the heavier the burdens for the things that He's carrying. Because there's times where I'm praying, and I will have this heavy, heavy, sometimes it's not comfortable, it doesn't feel good. I'll have this heavy burden or this weight for someone, for people, for a place, for a thing, and it just becomes like almost too weighty to bear. What is that? That is the Lord sharing His heart with me, so I will do something with it. So I will exercise the effectual, fervent prayer that avails much, so that God will allow me to partner with His will to carry that burden that He has. What a huge privilege. And let me just say, the qualification I have to do that is son. What's your qualification? Son, daughter. No special people, just sons and daughters, which I guess are the special people, right? Okay. Would you stand to your feet? I've gone long. I'm going to have to change my plan. I want to play a video for you in just a moment. Romans 8, the final point is fervent prayer is empowered by His Spirit. Oh, I had you stand up. I shouldn't have you stand up. Sit back down. We talked about this the other day. Thank you. Thank you for obeying. I just had the burden that you would stretch in that moment. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know what to pray for as we ought, but the Spirit himself intercedes for us with groanings too deep for words. Number four, fervent prayer is empowered by his Spirit. There is prayer of the flesh, and there is prayer of the Spirit. For the believer, for the vessel who contains we are the temple of the Holy Spirit wants desperately for us to pray in the Spirit, not in our flesh, not in our intellect, not in our experience, not even in your super high IQ. Because I have news for us. His IQ is higher. His power is greater than your fine reasoning, your fine intellect, and even your fine eloquent verbalizing of eloquent prayer. My favorite thing about effective fervent prayer is the Bible even says sometimes it's just groans and utterances. So if you think it has to do with your use of the English language, think again. Because sometimes the dumbest sounding prayers that have come out of my mouth have had the most effect. Because it's not about my intellect, it's not about my handling of the English language, it's not about how eloquently I can verbalize stuff. It is about the Spirit of God coming into agreement with the Word of God and me just simply being a vessel of what he wants to do. So, if you want to know what fervent prayer is like, here's an example. Go ahead.
You've done it again, Lord. You've done it again. You are good and you are mighty and you are merciful. And you keep taking care of me when I don't deserve it. Praise you, Jesus. You are Lord. Give me another one, Lord. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up. Lord, we need a generation of believers who are not ashamed of the gospel. We need an army of believers, Lord, that hate to be lukewarm. And will stand on your word above all else. Raise them up, Lord. Raise them up. I pray for unity among those that love you. I pray that you open their eyes so that they can see your truth, Lord. I pray for your hand of protection and guidance. Raise up a generation, Lord, that will take light into this world, that will not compromise when under pressure, that will not cower, Lord, when others fall away. Raise them up, Lord, that they will proclaim that there is salvation in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees. Who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle that we may proclaim you King of kings and Lord of lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
Anyone who is in right standing, that's what righteous means. Anyone who is in right standing can pray the prayer of faith. Anyone who is in right standing, their effectual, fervent prayer, their active prayer will do much, will accomplish much. Sometimes we think that that applies to somebody else. Like we said earlier, Jesus gave you and I free access. If you are in him, your prayers avail much. But Pastor, you don't know what I did. The great thing is we have another verse that says, He is faithful to forgive. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse us of unrighteousness. If you're feeling like your prayers are missing, it only takes, God, get me right. Jesus, forgive me. God, forgive my heart, forgive whatever. Get me right with you so that I can be in right standing, because Lord, I want to partner with you. I want my prayer to avail much. I want to see things happen. Now you can stand to your feet. That's part of the Mountain Life exercise program. So here's what we're doing for 21 days. We're going to pray as though your prayer and my prayer avail much. We're going to pray as though God is going to do something amazing, supernatural, earth-shattering. But specifically, what we're going to pray is his will. What's his will? Well, first and foremost, it is not his will that anyone should perish. Jesus said, pray to the Lord of the harvest, for the harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. So we're taking 21 days, and we are praying specifically. We're doing a devotional every day together, which includes worship, some reading, some prayer time. I want you to avail yourself to that. It's going to be a great time. We're going to come together. The building is open Monday through Thursday for prayer. We have it posted. It's online. It's on the app as well. We also have prayer meetings, 9 o'clock Sunday mornings in the fireside room. You can come join us. If we get too big, we'll just come in here. And we're going to take the next 21 days, pursuit nights, this week out by the fire pit. We're going to pray together, but we are going to pray what God wants us to pray for the world around us. And there's prayer cards right up here. On your way out today, if you would just file up and grab one, I want you to pray and ask God who or where or what he would have you pray for. And this one is specifically, I mean, it's okay to pray that your car would not break down, but this 21 days, we're praying for that neighbor. We're praying for that prodigal. We're praying for that person at work. We're praying for that, maybe that even that politician. It is still God's will. We're praying for maybe that person who you have conflict with. But whatever it is, we are praying specifically for where God's heart is for this next 21 days. And you can fill out as many cards as you want. What we're going to do after you fill it out, we're going to put it right here. You can bring it during the week. You can bring it Thursday night. You can bring it during the Sunday service. We're going to put them here, and we're going to take 21 days to pray over every single prayer card together, as we also pray individually and see what God is going to do. So Lord, in Jesus' name, would you partner us with you? Lord, for those that are here today that are afar off, would you bring them back to you? Would you restore them to you? And Lord, would you allow us, Lord, to just break off the junk that keeps us from having a fervent, active prayer life? God, would you use this season to reinvigorate, reignite? Lord, would you put on our heart, would you break our hearts for the things that break yours? Lord, would you rev us up to come into agreement with what you want to do? And God, we just say, it's time, Lord. It's time. Lord, we're here. We're your people. Lord, we want to do what you'll have us do. Lord, it's time to drop the clutch. It's time for us to pray the effectual, fervent prayers. In Jesus' name, amen.